What in the world should the church be doing? That's a great question. What in the world should the church be doing? We are in a series where we are looking at the early church and kind of patterning ourselves. I'll talk about that in a moment. But today, I'd like to tell you about the end of the world. That certainly sounds ominous, doesn't it? Well, I thought it would be a good thing to do. So let's have a word of prayer and we'll begin. Father, I pray, bless this time. Let the word of Christ dwell richly in us. Thank you for how great and how wonderful you are. Lord, thank you for the music. It was a foretaste of the worship of heaven this morning. Thank you for the mandolin and the violin and the trumpet and the piano and the flute. And Lord, how just like David got excited about these instruments praising you. They lead us, our hearts to open and to praise you. You are worthy of all of our praise. And so give us a good time in the word. We love you, Father. We need you now in Jesus' name. Amen. The end of the world. I guess it's the nature of humanity to live in sort of a status quo ignorance about things that are coming. You know, we like, you know, things never to change. We just like things to be the same. It's like that also in history past when catastrophic events have happened, that, you know, people were just living the normal way the day before. On December 6, 1941, things were very peaceful in America, and of course the next day Pearl Harbor was bombed. On April 14, 1912, everything was quiet. The next day the Titanic sank. On January 27, 1986, all was well, and the next day the Challenger exploded. On April 25, 1986, all was fine, and the next day was the Chernobyl disaster. Christmas Day 2004 was joyous in Indonesia. And then the very next day brought a humongous tsunami of historic proportions, killing thousands upon thousands of people. Of course, we could speak about World War I and about World War II and probably the ultimate and for Americans to feel what I'm talking about going in the status quo ignorance is September 10th. Everything's just normal. September 11th, our lives changed radically. My point is this. We can and we will continue to live one day at a time, won't we? I mean, that's what we got to do. We got to put one foot in front of the other, one day after the other, or front of the other. But there is a time coming, folks, when time will be no more. And we can go along in our status quo ignorance, and that's fine, but there is a radical change that is on the horizon. There is a time when days and countries and schedules and histories will not continue the way that we know it. It is called the end of the world. Today, we would like to study it, and we're going to call this doctrine eschatology, because that's the name of it, the study of last things. And I want to give a shout out just one more time to Pastor Valiente, who has helped with some study notes that he did years ago and has helped outline some of the things that we're working through with these nine major doctrines. These nine major doctrines we're studying is in this series, What in the World Should the Church Be Doing? And we're studying them because we've come really to the third point. Let's yell it out if you know the points. It's in the front of your bulletin. It's hanging around posters, even in the bathrooms of this church. All right, what's the first one? Yell it out. Reaching. The early church was reaching. They were giving the gospel. People were coming to be saved. All right, the second one is what? Involving. When those people came, it wasn't just like this, like what we do, buffet churching, like we see around us in America. It wasn't like hippity-hoppity in the next church or whatever. There was a drawing together, an incredible involving, a brother-sisterly love that went through trials and troubles and hardships and pride with each whatever, and didn't run away, didn't hippity-hoppity to the next church. It was a drawing together. They were involving each other and worshiping and getting to know each other and open up their hearts and becoming transparent to each other and getting involved and serving the Lord. It was a real family kind of a thing we saw. And then the next one is what? Involving in maturing. That's where we are now. And we started this out by that phrase in Acts 2. Acts 2 is where we've been working through these phrases one at a time. And it was they continued steadfastly in doctrine. And we've started this off, we've kicked this maturing off with looking really at the nine major doctrines of what every New Testament church needs to build the church on. We're coming to the end of them. I skipped over one. This is the last one, eschatology. The one I skipped over is called ecclesiology. And it is the study of the church. Well, our whole series is the study of the church, so I figured we don't have to go over that one right now. And so we're going to end today with eschatology. Eschatology, the study of last things. Turn your Bible to 2 Peter. With that introduction, let's go to 2 Peter and start studying last things. 2 Peter chapter 3, please, in your Bible. 2 Peter chapter 3. Second Peter chapter 3. It's towards the end. It's obviously after 1 Peter. It's before the three Johns in the back. Three Johns, Jude, and Revelation. 2 Peter chapter 3. Would you stand, please? Let's read. This is what God says this morning. This is what God says. Thus saith the Lord. The second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, 2 Peter 3, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before of the holy prophets, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things can... Oh, this is what they're saying for. Let me get the intuition, or in whatever that is, in there again, verse 4. Let me say the whole thing the way the scoffers do. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. And this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. The worldwide flood. Things did not continue since the beginning the same way. Verse 7, but the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years is one day. Look up here. So these scoffers are saying, you know, thousands of years have gone by. You know, everything is, you know, nothing's different. You say that you're a believer in God, you that he's going to come back and judge the world, and nothing ever changes. It's all the same. But listen, God's timing is different than our timing. His soon is certainly different than our soon. You know, he's an infinite God who knows no time and no boundaries. So the scoffers are kind of foolish in saying that. They just don't have the picture of who God is. So look at verse number 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, that is, of returning and judging the world and judging ungodly men. He's not slack concerning that. He's not lazy concerning that. He hasn't procrastinated, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He's merciful in delaying. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are in them shall be burned up, seeing that all these things, you know, the whole earth and heaven shall be dissolved. What manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Peter is talking to Christians. Looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God. That means, like, looking for Jesus to return in judgment and hastening by your holy life. Wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heaven and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things, be diligent that you be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless, and account that the longsuffering of our God, of our Lord, is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. You may be seated. Going to move Pastor Pritt's trumpet stand, lest I be impaled. So here's a passage on eschatology. It's on last things. It has some mountain peaks about what is going to happen in the future, and I want to tell you right away that it's important, as you look at any particular passage in Scripture about prophecy, whether it be in Daniel or whether it be in Revelation or whether it be in Isaiah or here in the epistles, that you understand the principle of mountain peaks. You know, the Lord has laid out by his prophets, by the guys who wrote the Word of God, that it would be kind of like looking across a mountain range, that you could see in the different passages the big peaks, but you couldn't see what was down in the valley. And as you study through that, it's important to understand that all these passages have to be harmonized together, that you won't get any full view of the timeline of what's going to happen in eschatology, the end of all things, by one particular passage. In fact, here, the encouragement of Peter to Christians is not talking about the rapture. He is talking about the second coming and the judgment of the Lord that will happen as a thief in the night. Okay, so the people that will still be here during that time, judgment will overrun them. And this is how he is laying out the petition. It is a mountain peak that is downrange in the timeline of prophecy. Look at the passage. Verse 4 is certainly the feeling of skeptics who don't believe God, or even right now, won't believe that he'll judge the world. It's Bill Nye, the science guy, and everybody else. Where is the promise of his coming? Days march on, really the same since my old grandpappy's died. Since forever back in history, it's all the same. Days continue from creation. But that's not really true, the scripture says. It says, I remind you that there was a picture of a great judgment already. I remind you by the layering of stone and by great changes that you can see that happened on the earth, that there already was a great judgment that is not even going to be a little bit, not even going to be tip of the iceberg compared to the judgment that's coming. It was called the worldwide flood. He says, if you would be honest about that, you would understand that I judged one time. Verse 7 and 10 and 11 says that the heavens and the earth will burn with fire. It has to do with the judgment of ungodly men at the end, and that won't repent of their sin, will not take Jesus Christ as Savior. Verse 10 says this judgment will come without notice, as I've already said, as a thief in the night. It'll be then, during that time, just like any other day. Verse 8 and 9 gives us the reason that God has been delaying, that he is merciful and he's given sinners an opportunity, a chance to repent. But I would just tell you, and many that I've talked to that have not yet trusted Christ as your Savior, you think you have plenty of time to procrastinate it, that even God's mercy will come to an end for sinners who reject his love. Tomorrow is not the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. You cannot guarantee your time tomorrow. You can't guarantee that you're going to be alive. You can't guarantee that the great wheel of prophecy will not swing forward. And we'll talk about that in a moment. Today is the day. Settle it now. Verse 11 and 14 is preaching to Christians, those of us who are trusting Jesus to save us. It says that if all these earthly things are going to be dissolved, all of our things that we know on earth, all of the organizations and all of the buildings and all the time and all of this these relationships, if they're all going to be dissolved, then we must not live for this world. This must not be our purpose, brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, the fact that Christ is returning and the fact that he's going to burn all this stuff up, it should tell us that those motorcycles and those cars and those RVs and those second, third, fourth, fifth houses and all the things that we may put in our minds as something to live for, a purpose to live for, or a God to live for, that's not what we should be living for. They're all going to be burned up. They're all going to be ashes. We must live instead for the great first commandment, that the Lord our God, to love him with all of our hearts, that there's no other God before him. We must live for him. Verse 14 commands us to be diligent, to be peaceful while we're waiting for the end, to be peaceful, without spot, and blameless. And you know, the view here of Christ returning is to live appropriately, honoring the great judge who is coming. Holy lives, believers, that says we believe that Jesus is coming again. That lives like what you believe, the faith of what you believe in. Godly lives, the verse 12 says that they look for, and this is a crazy phrase that always has you know, kind of done me in circles in verse number 12, and hasting Jesus' return. And there is this dynamic that believers, Christians on the earth, living godly lives, actually, speed up the return of Jesus Christ. It hastens Our godly, blameless living even hastens the return of Jesus. Of course, Christ, that verse 12, the word blamelessness, Christ is our righteousness. He is our blamelessness. But the Lord in the New Testament has told us that we must live diligently blameless because he has declared us to be blameless by justification. The bride of Christ will be presented to him, a glorious church, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Oh, believers, what a great thing it is that we are truly, as we preach, justified. That we are truly blameless in the Lord Jesus Christ. All right? But here is the thing. It's not a however, it's an and. The and is this. The Lord has told us while we were here fighting our flesh, while we're fighting this sin, and while we're fighting the devil, we should live like what we are. We should live as we have been made. We should live as we have been saved. You are positionally justified. The Lord will not impute to you your sin. You're covered with the Teflon of the blood of Jesus Christ. But he says, live like what I've declared you to be when I saved you. That is the goal, and that is our fight. It's not easy, brothers and sisters. We fail repeatedly. But in view of the coming of the Lord, this must be our diligent fight. Verse 13 says that we look for a new heavens and a new earth wherein dwells righteousness. Are you looking for that kingdom? I mean, come on, let's be serious. Look at all you. You guys just came through that election a couple weeks ago, whenever it was. Don't tell me you're not looking for a better kingdom. We are thrilled to think of the day that there will be a righteous king who will be on the throne of the world. He will rule with a rod of iron. We're going to get to that just in a moment. But aren't you thrilled that this earth and these heavens that are sin-cursed will certainly be dissolved away by fire? I'm thrilled of that. My eyes have seen something much more beautiful than sin. I have seen the glory of the Lord in Jesus Christ. I have seen that that living for God is a much better way to live. Nobody compels me to do this. My eyes have been opened. I have seen that Jesus' way is always the best way. I want to live with my family. I want to live my life. I want to live with my relationships. I want to live with my thought life. I want to live with my body in God's glorious ways. That's the better way. That's the most beautiful way. And there is that king, that great righteous king is going to come, and he's going to rule the world that way. What a day that's going to be, the new heavens and the new earth. So these are the broad strokes in this passage. Again, these are just mountain peaks in 2 Peter 3 of eschatology. I'd like to get you down in the valley, all right? Not like in a negative way, not like discourage you. I'd like to show you the valleys between the mountain peaks. There are three in eschatology, the study of last things. There are three major views of the last times of what is going to happen here that Christians have historically held. And you should know them. This is good for your knowledge to understand. So there has been the view called amillennialism. Amillennial, and we have a chart here if you want to just kind of focus on that chart while I'm talking. In this view of last things, there is no rapture. There is no millennium. And in this view, Christ comes only once in judgment, and believers live with him forever and ever. So what theologians do that hold to that view, they just kind of lump all the verses together, and they just see like one judgment, whatever. It's a very simplistic view. It is not a very literal view in Scripture. There's a second kind of view. It's called post-millennialism. You know what post is? It's like after, not like the mailman post, but it means like after. It means that Christ comes in the end of a kind of millennium. And the millennium is not literally 1,000 years in this view. Post-millennialism, in this view, the church on earth gets stronger and stronger and stronger. So these people believe that more and more and more and more people get saved. More and more things come under the dominance of Jesus Christ while we're here on earth, like now. It'll get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger, and it'll get so strong that it will usher in the coming of Christ. Like the majority of the earth will get saved, be saved, and then, you know, Jesus thinks that it's okay to come, and then he comes and is the king. In this view, there is no rapture. There is only this second coming of Christ, kind of at the end of the millennium, the idea of the millennium. This This view considers the church and spiritual Israel as one thing. So it doesn't believe that there's any difference between the church now, okay, Bible-believing churches, churches, Gentiles getting saved. It doesn't believe that there's any difference between that and Israel. It just says that the church, you know, when Gentiles began getting saved, and obviously there are many more Gentiles that are saved now than Jews, that it was the fulfilled promises to Israel spiritually. And so it says, this view says that there, Israel will never get a literal kingdom and a never a literal king, and will never, you know, be known as the people of God again and things like that. This view was held strongly. This was the predominant view held for hundreds and hundreds of years in Christian churches, and it was only kind of debunked or kind of challenged about 100 years ago. And when Christianity was on the rise and it was gaining powerful influence about 200 years ago, whatever, this is how they thought it was going to happen. Church getting stronger, 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 and then Jesus Christ would come and reign. Finally, there is the view called premillennialism. And this is the view that I hold, that our church holds, premillennialism. And I'm not going to show you a chart, because the chart that comes along with this is very detailed, because it includes all the passages, and if I put it up there, it's just like stuff all over the place. But I want to talk to you about it. It's more complicated, but I want to teach it to you today, premillennialism. And this is the literal view of Scripture rather than an allegorical view of Scripture. So when verses are read, we really believe that when it says that Jesus Christ is going to come for believers in the air, that he's really going to come for believers, and that Jesus Christ is going to return premillennial. He's going to come before he comes back again to rule the world, and he's going to take believers up in the air. We call it the rapture. I'll talk about it in a minute. This view just takes Scripture literally as its word, at its word, and it arranges the passages, the different prophetic passages, to get one understanding of eschatology, of what's going to happen in the end days. This view, premillennialism, is based on another theological teaching that's called dispensationalism. How many of you have heard that word, dispensationalism? Okay, most of you, three-quarters of you, dispensationalism. So what is that $50 word? Well, a dispensation is a period of time, okay? And this theology is that over a period, that over all of history, God has dealt with mankind in seven different ways, in different ages. Like he dealt with Adam and Eve during the age of innocence one way. And then later on, he would deal with Abraham a different way. And then he established governance, whatever. I'm going to show you the seven ages. And as you read the scripture and you think about this, you see God dealing differently. This doesn't change salvation. It's not, you know, making different salvations. It's just you see God dealing with mankind different ways. There's the age of innocence, the age of conscience, the age of government, the age of promise. This is all the promise of the covenants of God, whatever. The age of law, you know, when the law reigned before Christ came. And then six, the age of grace, church, or the age of the church that we're in right now. And then in the last days, when Christ comes again, the age of Christ, or of eternity. And some people, you know, name them kind of different things, but this is just the general idea of dispensationalism, that God has worked in different ways through the ages with mankind to bring him ultimately to Jesus Christ. This view holds that Israel is God's chosen nation, and that the church is something totally different, that we were grafted in to salvation, but that all the promises to Israel will literally be still fulfilled in the future, that they will have a kingdom, that Israel will come to the Lord nationally. We'll see it in a moment. That they will turn to the Lord. And some believers through the ages did not believe that. They thought that was all fulfilled, as I said, in the church. Dispensationalism believes God will keep all his literal promises. Now, dispensationalism and those thinking, and you read books on it, it's not a perfect view, but it is a literal scriptural view. Now, listen, I'm going to be honest with you. I can't wait till the day that Jesus Christ in heaven says, okay, this is, you know, this was almost there. You got this like 75%, but this is exactly this or whatever. There are some things like prophecy that are like that, that either he'll explain to us a little clearer in eternity or it won't even matter, right? We're just already there. So this is a literal scriptural view. This is what we teach here at Lighthouse. It's what we believe. The competing view to dispensationalism of these time periods is what is called covenant theology. How many of you ever heard of that? Covenant theology, all right? Covenant theology doesn't believe in the ages of time where God is dealing differently with mankind. It believes that God dealt differently with mankind through time, through promises, covenants, like the Abrahamic covenant, for instance, the Mosaic covenant, the David, the Davidic covenant. And you can definitely see these covenants, you know, in Scripture. Most of the people who would hold this would be Reformed believers, a lot of Presbyterian believers. They would see God moving in history through these major promises, covenants, rather than the dispensation. Now, let me just see this. I certainly see in Scripture those covenants as big. If you read your Bible and through the Old Testament, you can see that there is something going on, these big promises that change a lot of stuff. Abraham and Moses and David and these big promises. But I want to say to you, it doesn't have to be one way or the other. It's not like, you know, it's either dispensations or it's covenants. Both thoughts can work together. God's promises to mankind in the dispensation of time, I don't think there's any problem with that, that you have to say, oh, God's not doing anything through the covenants if you believe in the dispensations. So having said that as a basis of how to view what's going on at the end, let's talk about the details, okay? Let's talk about the great deal details. What are we expecting? What is it that's going to happen next on God's great calendar? Well, number one, there will be a rapture of all believers. A rapture of all believers. That's a great word, isn't it? Rapture? Some get messed up that exact word is not in the Scripture, the word rapture. You know, it's kind of like Sunday school. That's not in the Scripture either, but we do it, and it's a good thing. Rapture. You can see so many passages that talk about, many passages that talk about the Lord Jesus coming back, not like 2 Peter 3, not in the judgment sense, but in the gathering of his bride, in the gathering of his children. It's a completely different event, different thing. Hear the word of God on this. 1 Thessalonians 4 says this, "For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that they which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord," or when the Lord comes, "shall not prevent," okay, a good old word, it means go before. They're not going to go before those that are asleep. Well, that's a really nice old word for what? Yell it out. What? Dead. Okay, yeah. "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." See, that's the order. "Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them." With who? The dead bodies that are rejoining their spirits that are already with the Lord. And of course, with the Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to be caught up together with them in the what? In the clouds. Is Jesus touching down on the earth during the rapture? No, we're going to meet him up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the what? Yell it out. What is it? In the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. This presents great problems for those who just believe in one, in the second coming, just Christ coming one time and not a rapture beforehand. This explains something else. It's not even like our 2 Peter 3 passage that's talking about judgment. There are so many passages that show this, 1 Corinthians 15, other places of this irrefutable event. And I would say this meeting in the clouds, we notice that from this verse and other verses, it's not one of judgment, Jesus collecting his bride. It is a sweet reunion. He's not coming to judge the ungodly at this moment. He is coming to get his sweet believers. It's a wonderful reunion of the dead and the living that are in Jesus, that have put their trust in Jesus Christ, being gathered to Jesus and forever being with the Lord. Our 2 Peter judgment. The Bible said, remember, your Bibles are probably still open to it, it'll come as a thief in the night. And that judgment of him coming in what we call the second coming after the rapture will take people by surprise. But this passage also, I mean, not just this passage, this event also, the rapture that we're waiting for, is also talked about as the word imminent, which means that it will happen at any moment too. We'll just be going along. Some of you will be heading to a doctor's appointment. Some of you will be, you know, just eating your Wheaties. Some of you will, you know, or Cheerios, whatever you eat. You know, it's good for your heart. Some of you will, you'll be going along. You'll maybe be duck hunting. I don't know. You'll be at the mall wasting your money. Some of you will be sitting in front of the television. Ah, please, Lord, don't come when I'm sitting in front of the television. How embarrassing. What a waste. All right? It will just be like normal. And that trumpet will blast. And that archangel will shout. And Jesus will say, come to me. Come on home. The old song says, it may be at morn, when the day is awaking, when sunlight through darkness and shadow is breaking, that Jesus will come in the fullness of glory to receive from the world his own. All joy, all delight, should we go without dying. No sickness, no sadness, no dread, and no crying. Caught up through the clouds with our Lord into glory when Jesus receives his own. Oh, Lord Jesus, how long ere we shout the glad song? Christ returneth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, amen. Or amen for all you Presbyterians. There are some appointments that I would rather not keep. It'd be all right if Jesus would come right now, wouldn't it? There are some bills I'd rather not pay. There are days of temptation that I would rather not face. Soon after the rapture comes the tribulation period. Number two, the tribulation period. This is a period of time, tribulation, that is a rough period of time. I'll explain it in just a moment. But it's a period of time after the rapture that happens on this planet, on this world, after believers are gone. There are really two reasons for the tribulation period that are bore out in Scripture. One is to bring Israel back to the Lord. This is going to be the time that Israel is going to return to the Lord. And there in Scripture's a lot of more detail that I'm not going to give. There's two evangelists that rise up. They call, you know, to God's people. But the Scripture says in Romans 11 about this, for I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel. Okay, that's, most Jews will not listen to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Very few Jews are saved right now. So blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. I think that's just a general way of saying until the end of the church age, until the rapture happens. And so, verse 26, and so all Israel shall be saved. This is only one of many places that talk about nationally, in mass, Israel believing on Jesus. As it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, that's Christ, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. This is a crazy thing indeed, and yet the New Testament makes it quite clear that during the tribulation period, Israel as a nation turns in mass to Jesus as Savior. The blinders are taken off, and they can see that he is not only a prophet among prophets, that he is the Messiah, that he is their Christ. And how amazing that will be. But the second purpose of this tribulation period is kind of the opposite. It is to judge the Gentile nations that resisted God and persecuted Israel. It is to begin judgment. So the Bible talks, if you look at different passages, Daniel, Revelation, on this tribulation period, the Bible speaks of 3.5 years of peace. It starts out really nice. It starts out better than the world has been ever. But then it ends in 3.5 years of incredible, horrible judgment depicted, especially Daniel, Revelation. I want to give you a resource on this because we're just flying over this morning. But in 2007, we preached through the book of Revelation. And that is on our YouTube channel, and it gives specifically, we went through all the judgments, we went through all the exact, it's a great resource for you. It's not on our website, you can't click it there, but you can go to our YouTube channel, if some of you know how to do that, to get to it. If you don't want to go through all of that, if you just email me, I'll send you my notes, they're manuscript, I mean, you can just read them and see the detail if you're interested in this. After the rapture, the Bible says, at the beginning of this tribulation, a man, Scripture refers to as Antichrist or the beast, will rise up. And he will be an amazing man. He will broker peace with the entire world, beginning with making a covenant with Israel. And somehow, we don't know how that all is, that peace that he brokers for the world begins the tribulation period of time. And Daniel 9 speaks of this covenant with Israel. Imagine Israel being at peace with the world. I want to tell you, one of the very simple things that would cause me to be a believer, if nothing else, would be just the history of Israel in relationship to the rest of the world, how much the rest of the world hates Israel. I mean, just that little piece alone, you know, shows that the scripture is true. That little piece alone, who care? They shouldn't care about Israel. They do everything they can do to wipe them out and take their land and kill them. There's obviously a Satan. There is obviously an evil agenda over that. Or no one wouldn't care. It would be like the Bahamas or wherever. All right? You know, there you go, PJ. It would be about, it would be just like any other little teeny weeny country. It wouldn't matter. But the Bible is true. And people do hate Israel for some unknown reason. So it starts in peace, but Daniel 9:27, this tribulation says that time will be cut in half as Antichrist breaks his covenant with Israel. And then he reveals himself as a tool of what Revelation 12 calls the red dragon, which is Satan. And that he is really a tool in the hand of Satan. He is not the Messiah to the world. He is Antichrist, not Christ. Revelation chapter 6 through 10, or excuse me, through 15, describes a book. And it's a book of justice that no one is worthy to open except the Lamb, Jesus. And he opens this book in heaven. This is, I assume, a kind of metaphorical kind of thing of judgment. He opens seven seals and then seven trumpets and seven vials. These are all judgments on the head of Antichrist and on the head of the world. The last 3.5 years will be violence like no one has ever seen on this world. And hunger and war and pestilence and even beasts prevail. The culmination of the tribulation is a great battle. And you know it as Armageddon, the Battle of Armageddon. Scripture records that it doesn't start out with Jesus. It starts out with 200 million soldiers fighting against Antichrist. So after the peace breaks up, they turn against Antichrist and against his army. And the nations of the world unite against Antichrist and begin fighting. And then, in the middle of that battle, Jesus Christ comes as the great warrior from heaven that we're about to read about. And he comes, and when they see him coming in the air with the great armies of the Lord, which is us, and perhaps the angels, they get so afraid, they stop fighting against each other, and they start fighting and shooting and fighting Jesus Christ and his armies. They unite together, the millions. It's going to be a battle of battles. It's a coming of judgment. And what's interesting about that battle is that we will be with him. Hear the word of the Lord. Revelation 19. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, capital F, capital T. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire. And on his head there were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. Verse 14. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses. Here it is. Clothed in fine linen. White and clean. That description is not of angels. That's a description of the blood-washed saints of Jesus Christ. The bride of Jesus Christ, we will ride with him. we are going to fight with Jesus. At least we'll be in his army. He's going to do all the fighting. Because the scripture says that he'll smite the nations with a two-edged sword that's out of his mouth. One little word will fell his enemies. You cannot stand against the Creator. You cannot stand against the one who made the ends of the world. You cannot stand against the one who threw out the stars, and the little phrase in scripture, and he made the stars also, as if it were marbles across the living room floor. Who can stand against the Christ? Who can stand against Lord God Almighty, Jesus? No one. When the dust clears from this great battle of Armageddon, scripture records that the blood will be up to the horse's bridle. It will be a giant, righteous massacre of ungodliness by Jesus. It's interesting that we should note that the lamb is also the lion. We must not presume on the meekness of the lamb. We must also praise him as the great lion of Judah. During this 7-year tribulation, two things will happen in heaven. Did you hear me say in heaven? Yell out, in heaven. In heaven, not down here. Two things are recorded to happen in heaven during the 7-year tribulation. Number one, the judgment seat of Christ will occur, where all the saved through the ages, that's Yunzes, Ionses, will receive the things that are done in our bodies. How we live for Jesus in our saved bodies as Christians. Rewards will be given that will really matter for all eternity of service to Jesus in our lifetimes. And I try to compel you, this church, and I compel myself, that when it's all over, Rewards Day is really going to matter. It is not going to be just this simple thing, okay, for 30 minutes, whatever. I fully believe, by the way the scripture is laid out, that whatever rewards and accolades are given to us by Jesus Christ for our service right now will remain, that status will remain through all eternity. There will be hierarchy. There will be greater reward and lesser reward. The scripture warns us about this. This is why we must not be weary, brothers and sisters, in well-doing. We will reap if we faint not. This is why we cannot be lazy Christians, indifferent Christians, distracted Christians, disconnected Christians, burnt out Christians. Jesus Christ really will reward you for what you are doing right now for him. He really will say, well done, with great rewards, or as another passage of scripture says, that some believers will be saved so as by fire. That is barely. That is, yes, you will spend forever in heaven, but you will not be rewarded because you did not take seriously serving Jesus Christ with your life. 2 Corinthians 5:10 explains this judgment seat, or bema seat, some call it. For we must all appear, that's believers, before the judgment seat of Christ. There's no unbelievers here. That everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. That is the quality of your service to the Lord. Good service to Jesus or bad service to Jesus. Number two, something else happens in heaven during this time. The recognition of marriage. The recognition of marriage. And the supper of the Lamb also happens during the tribulation in heaven, where believers gather with Jesus to celebrate that they are one with Jesus forever and ever. Just this week, I got to explain to a young married couple about why we do some of the things in the marriage ceremony, the wedding ceremony that is tradition. And one of them is we have a great reception afterward, at least mostly, you know, it depends if you're from the north or the south. If you're from the north, you get mince and peanuts. If you're from the south, you get lasagna and roasted beef and chicken legs and whatever. That's just how they do marriage receptions. All right, so why is that there? Why did someone start doing that? Because Christians way, 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 way back in the past realized that that's just a picture of another marriage coming. And the picture of all of you who by faith are trusting Christ, there's going to be a great identification of that marriage, that we are forever joined with the Lord. It's called the marriage supper of the Lamb. It seems to be happening during all this chaos is happening down here during the tribulation. Revelation 19 says it this way, and I heard a voice, or excuse me, I heard as it were, the voice of great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. There it is. See, I told you, that's the identification. That's why, you know, that's clear that it's us riding horses with him. For fine linen is the righteousness of saints. That is the righteousness given to us by Jesus. Verse 9. And he saith unto me, Right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God. What a party that will be. What a reception that will be. I'll tell you what, Brother Sonny, we're not going to eat mints and peanuts. It's going to be an incredible time, an amazing gathering. All the Christians through the ages, all the believers that right now are meeting, you know, even in Newark and Bear and surrounding areas, you know, that we go to our different churches, and that's fine. There's reasons for that. But we're going to be all together as one around that table. Some of you sound like you're looking forward to that. Unfortunately, we got to go down back to the earth, okay? So leave that happy thought down to the earth. Obviously, the battle of Armageddon is after both the judgment seat and the marriage supper of the Lamb, because we are with Christ. The dust settles from the war, and Jesus does not return to heaven. And as I see it, we don't either. We stay here with Jesus, King Jesus. And he establishes for 1,000 years a perfect government. And we are his government workers. We are the ones who rule and reign. The meek shall inherit the earth, the scripture says. And we will reign. I personally would like to rule over New York City, Chicago, and, you know, some other places. I'm just kidding. West Virginia doesn't need rule. It's already perfect. What are you saying? We will reign with him, the scripture says, and he'll rule with a rod of iron for 1,000 years. That brings us to number 3. After the tribulation is the millennial kingdom. And I know what some of you 20 and 30 years old, this is not a kingdom made up of millennials. Thank the Lord for it. This is Christ reigning for 1,000 years on earth. He'll rule from Jerusalem, where he'll establish his throne over the world. The Bible says things like the glory of the kingdoms will bring their glory to him, you know? All promises to Israel will be fulfilled then, literal fulfillment. You know, a king of David will sit on the throne. His name is Jesus. And though it is a perfect government, sinful men will have survived, will have not been in the army of the millions that fought at Armageddon. Sinful people will survive. And beyond that, it's 1,000 years. Sinful babies will be born that will during, it's just unthinkable that Christ will physically be here, and yet there will be sinners who rebel against him. It's unthinkable to me, but it's true. Add to this that Satan, who was bound since the tribulation, he was bound for that 1,000-year millennial reign. At the end of that 1,000 years, he will be loosed. And he will deceive the nations, those who are not believers. He will lead a rebellion against King Jesus. The Bible says fire will fall down from heaven to destroy his satanic army. And Satan will be bound in the lake of fire forever and ever and ever. And I'm going to do this until you say amen. Ever and ever and ever. That accuser of the brethren, that lord of the flies, Lucifer, the red dragon, whatever you want to call him. There's coming a day where he will move around no more. It is sometime at this time that the great white throne will occur. Don't know exactly when. Revelation 20 says it this way, And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heavens fled away. There was found no place for them. There he is, the judge, King Jesus. The scripture says that God the Father has committed all judgment unto him. Verse 12, And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works, that is, their works of sin, And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to his works, to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. A preacher like me preaching this, a pastor like me preaching this, wishes at this moment for incredible moving of the Holy Spirit towards anyone here who is not written in the book of life. I cannot, with any theatrical speech, with any begging, with any tears, I cannot make what needs to happen in your heart happen right now. Only the Holy Spirit can give you the faith to believe that there is a judgment coming if you do not receive Christ as Savior right now. And it is a horrible, eternal judgment. These are all those who entered eternity without Jesus, those who would not listen to pastors preaching and Sunday school teachers teaching and Christian parents who told them that they need to be born again, or to tracts that were handed to them, or to missionaries, or to the creation that was crying out that there's an authority greater than themselves and they needed to know that authority. Small and great, the verse says, rich and poor, it makes no difference. If their name is not in the book of life, evidently a book with the names of all who believed, then they are cast in the real lake of fire, made for Satan originally and his minions forever and ever and ever. This is true stuff. This is not fairy tales in any way. Can I just pointedly say that there is no reason, absolutely no reason, for you to go to this judgment. There is no reason that anyone here has to go. Please listen to me. What sin of your life are you so fond of that you will not turn your back on, will not realize how wicked it is, so that you can take Jesus Christ and all of his beautiful promises and all the things that come with Christ? What sin against God could ever cause a man or a woman to say, I would rather have this pleasure of sin for the moment than eternal life, sharing all things with Jesus Christ in the future? It doesn't make logical sense. But you must have faith to believe that what the Bible says is so. The Lord is not waiting for you to clean yourself up. We saw that God justifieth the ungodly. Repentance is not making yourself perfect. Repentance is not promising God that you'll never sin again. Repentance is identifying that your sin is going to send you to hell. And you saying, God, I am a sinner. I don't want this to be on the throne of my heart anymore. I don't want to live for sin anymore. I want Jesus. Give me Jesus. I need a Savior. I'm drowning in my sin. I need the Savior. That is repentance and faith towards the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever would make you not give up sin. Whatever would make you, well, I can't. Someone told me this week, I cannot be saved because I want my sin. They actually said that to me. It blows my mind. Take him now as your loving Savior, and you'll never meet him as the terrible judge. After the millennium, finally, after the judgment is eternity. Eternity. Revelation 21:1 says this, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Remember that from our 2 Peter passage, what Jesus is going to do? He's going to burn up. Somewhere in the end of that judgment, whatever, before this, he did it. He did it. He made a new heaven, new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. And by heavens here, that we're talking about the clouds and the sky, what surrounds here in our atmosphere here. And not talking about heaven like the city. That's coming. And there was no more sea. Did you ever know that? In the new heaven and the new earth, there's no more sea. I don't know why. You say, well, I like the beach a lot. Okay, it's going to be all right. There's going to be a lot of great things. going to be a river. We know about that river. Verse 2 says, "And I saw, and I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them." I will read that again. "And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying. Neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said unto me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." And he said unto me, "It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end." Now look at this phrase. Please look at this phrase. "I will give unto him that is athirst or thirsty of the fountain of water of life freely." Grace, salvation, free gift of eternal life to anyone who wants it. Verse 7. "He that overcometh shall inherit all things." That's those who drink from Jesus. "And I will be his God, and he shall be my son and daughter." That's eternity, folks. What a day. What a day it's going to be. Have there ever been sweeter words to the ears? Jesus will make all things new. There is this holy city, four square. It's a cube, evidently, scripture. I don't understand that. We call it heaven. Evidently, it's going to hover over this new earth. The gates will never shut. We'll go in and out to the new earth. I don't understand it at all. But I am banking all my trust on Jesus Christ, who told me that I can believe on him freely and that I can drink eternal life freely just by faith in him. You and I will dwell in that city. Let me just say this. The mansions aren't going to compare to Jesus. Pearls, the gates made of pearl is impressive. It's not going to compare to Jesus. The streets of pure gold are going to be impressive. They're not going to compare to Jesus. Frankly, I doubt whether any of us will care anything about those things. We will care about the one who made it possible to share all things with him forever and ever. This is eschatology, the study of last things. I apply it to two ways and we're done today. Number one, I've already applied it. Encourage those still in your sin, those whose sins have not been washed away and forgiven, come to Jesus and drink. Just believe on him that he did it all on that cross and the resurrection for you. Trust on Jesus right now. Number two, I apply it the way that 2 Peter 3 did to you believers. There needs to be an expectation of your life and of your day that Jesus may come today. There needs to be, that faith needs to change your life, that you would desperately and diligently fight after what Jesus has already made you, clean and pure, and that you would determine to die to yourself each day and to live like what he made you. Doing that shows by faith you're looking for his return. And I don't know how, but the Bible says even hastening his return. Would you bow your heads, please, across the room?